Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for attending 2021 Peace and War Virtual Summit at Norwich University in Vermont. My name is Yang Mo-Ku. I am Associate Professor of Political Science and Associate Director of Peace and War Center at Norwich University. I'm also serving as the Executive Director for Peace and War Summit this year. Excuse me. Last Wednesday, we addressed the topics of China and Russia military cooperation and U.S.-China rivalry. Also, another significant issue, China's Belt and Road Initiative and its implications for U.S.-China rivalry. Today, we will grapple with another significant issue, China-Taiwan relations. As we know, the Taiwan issue is one of the key flashpoints that can lead to military conflict between the U.S. and China. Today, Dr. Joel Wuthnow at National Defense University will give a talk on Chinese military strategy toward Taiwan, and Dr. David Ulbrich will moderate this session. Let me briefly introduce Dr. Ulbrich. He's Associate Professor and Director of the Online Masters of Arts in History and Military History programs here at Norwich University. His teaching and scholarship focuses on the Asia-Pacific in the Second World War, and on U.S. Marine Corps history in the 20th century. His publications include the award-winning book titled Preparing for Victory, Thomas Holcomb and the Making of the Modern Marine Corps, 1936 to 1943, and the co-authored textbook World War II, A Global History, that will be published later this spring. Now, I turn it over to Dr. Ulbrich.
Thank you, Dr. Ku. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Joel Wuthnow. He is a senior research fellow at the Center for the Study of Chinese Military Affairs in the Institute for National for Strategic Studies at the National Defense University. His research includes Chinese foreign and security policy, Chinese military affairs, U.S.-China relations and strategic developments in East Asia. In addition to Dr. Wuthnow's duties at NDU, he also serves as an adjunct professor at the Edmund A. Walsh School for Foreign Service at Georgetown University. He has published several books, including Chinese Diplomacy and the UN Security Council with Routledge Press, China's Other Army, the People's Armed Police in the Era of Reform, Chairman Xi's remakes the PLA, Assessing Chinese Military Reforms as co-editor, and most recently, System Overload, Can China's Military Be Distracted in a War Over Taiwan? Most all these were published by National Defense University Press. Dr. Wuthnow holds degrees from Princeton University, Oxford University, and his doctorate in political science from Columbia University. Today's presentation is titled Chinese Military Strategy Towards Taiwan. As a reminder, please type in your questions in the question box, and we'll get to those after the presentation. And now I will turn things over to Dr. Joel Wuthnow to talk about this timely and critical topic. Sir.
Okay, well, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much to Professor Ku, to Professor Ulbrich, and the whole team there at Norwich University for inviting me and giving me a chance here to talk about this critical topic, which is China's military strategy towards Taiwan. Okay, so this is a really newsworthy topic. I think, you know, many of you have seen recent comments in the press about the potential for Chinese use of force against Taiwan. This is growing out of a number of different developments. First, heated rhetoric from senior Chinese leaders, including Xi Jinping. Second, incredible progress in Chinese military modernization and capabilities, some of which are completely relevant to Taiwan scenarios. And third, increasing military coercion by the People's Liberation Army directed at Taiwan. And so recently we have seen just a number of statements suggesting or speculating that China may at some point in the not too distant future be tempted to use force against Taiwan. And really, the stakes here are huge for the United States and for Taiwan. Taiwan, of course, is an island democracy of 23 million people located precariously close to the Chinese mainland, 150 kilometers or so offshore. Under the threat of Chinese invasion, China mainland considers Taiwan a renegade province. And for the United States, of course, this is not just a question of protecting a democracy in the Indo-Pacific region. This is also a question of U.S. credibility in its commitments to its allies as well as its partners, and whether or not the United States would be willing ultimately to use force to help protect Taiwan in an emergency. Okay, so what I'm going to talk to you today about are a number of interrelated topics. First, what is China's military strategy and where does Taiwan fit into it? Secondly, how is China using military coercion to deter Taiwan independence? Third, how would China fight a war if it came to that? How would China fight a war against Taiwan? And then finally, how should and how are the United States and Taiwan responding to an increased threat of military force from China? All right, so first of all, China's military strategy is quite broad. Options to use force against Taiwan are nested within it. China does indeed have a military strategy. They refer to this as military strategic guidelines. This is roughly equivalent to, in the United States, the former quadrennial defense review, a periodic assessment of China's security environment and of changing technology, changing operational concepts, essentially the changing character of warfare. And the combination of these assessments leads to different guidelines on how China should develop its forces, deploy its forces, change its training, change its organization, and so on. And so China periodically goes through the same kind of strategic assessment exercise as the United States and other countries do to determine how it should build its forces. All right, so China has gone through many iterations of a military strategy. During the Cold War, China's military was basically focused on countering an invasion or fighting a war against the superpowers, the United States at times, the Soviet Union at other times. And so the PLA during the Cold War was heavily a ground force centric organization. They were training and preparing to fight a land war against a superpower. Beginning in the 1980s, China shifted more towards a focus on regional conflicts, shorter but still high intensity conflicts against neighboring countries and indeed against Taiwan. And the reason for this was the reduction in China's perception that it would ever have to fight a war against the superpower, combined with China's growing offshore interests. And so there was more attention to, for instance, being able to fight a conflict against Vietnam or fight a conflict against Japan or other regional actors. At the same time, however, the PLA was also changing the way in which it would fight conflict. So it was focused less on land warfare and more on being able to fight modern joint operations and being able to fight high-tech wars. And it drew a number of lessons about how it could successfully fight offshore against a regional opponent from the US experience in the Gulf War. And so that really significantly impacted how China developed and modernized its forces. All right, so beginning in the late 1980s, but really from the early 1990s onwards, the geographic focus of China's military strategy shifted to the Southeast coast and in particular against Taiwan. And so while the PLA was also preparing for other regional contingencies, Taiwan really took center stage, and a conflict with Taiwan became the primary planning scenario for the PLA in terms of training, organization, acquisition, and so on. Why was this? One reason was that beginning in the late 1970s and into the 1980s, the Taiwan independence movement really took steam. And this was an affront to the Chinese Communist Party, one of whose primary interests was reunification with the motherland. And so the independence movement on Taiwan really threatened that long-term party objective. Second, at the same time, the nature of U.S.-China relations was also fundamentally changing. In the 1980s, China and the United States were quasi-allies against the Soviet Union. With the elimination of the Soviet Union and after the Tiananmen crisis in 1989, China-U.S. relations went very badly, and the United States turned its attention to other regional countries, including Taiwan, to which it provided significant military support. And so the threat that China faced from U.S. Intervention and from a stronger U.S.-Taiwan alignment was significant. And so these changes prompted Beijing to update and alter its military strategy to focus more on Taiwan. So what were the PLA's and what are the PLA's continuing goals towards Taiwan? So really, there are two things. First of all, in the near term, the PLA needs to be able to deter Taiwan independence. And so Taiwan has an independence movement, but it has never declared formal legal independence. And so China's goal is to deter Taiwan from taking that final step. And in this respect, China has been fairly successful. Even Taiwan's current administration under Tsai Ing-wen, who is relatively pro-independence leading, has never formally declared independence and recognizes the serious threat that Taiwan would face from China if they ever took that last step towards independence. The PLA's second goal is being able to lay the groundwork for eventual use of force to achieve unification. So this is a long-term goal. Really, what they need to be able to do is to use sufficient military force to convince Taiwan authorities to come to the negotiating table from a position of strength for China mainland. And barring that, if Taiwan leaders fail to do that, the PLA needs to be able to occupy and seize the main island of Taiwan, which would be a very significant military undertaking for the PLA. All right, so let me talk here about the first goal, which is deterring further steps towards Taiwan independence and how the PLA contributes to that objective. So first of all, China has been undergoing a very significant round of military modernization for the last 30 years. And that modernization has significantly changed the balance of military power across the Taiwan Strait. And so the latest information shows that in the air domain, China significantly outmatches the Taiwan Air Force, certainly in terms of bombers, less so in terms of fighters and other aircraft. In the sea domain, China strongly outweighs Taiwan in undersea warfare, and also in surface warfare. And then finally, in terms of conventional missiles, China has developed a massive inventory of short-range ballistic missiles, most of which are arrayed across the Taiwan Strait. And so all of these tools can certainly be used in an actual warfighting scenario, but in peacetime, they serve as a reminder, a deterrent signal to Taiwan that China is indeed serious about preventing independence. And China has, in fact, used or employed some of these assets in peacetime further to signal its intentions and its capabilities indeed to potentially use force if deterrence were to fail. All right, so how has it done that? So I'll give a few examples here. So first of all, in the air domain, China has over about the last 5 or 6 years begun consistent overwater bomber training using its Air Force bombers and developing bomber strike packages. And it has used those assets to fly around Taiwan to intimidate the Taiwan population and leadership. It has also flown out beyond the first island chain, even to the second island chain, as a sign that it has the capability to hold U.S. military facilities in the region out to Guam at risk. And so that has been a pretty clear sign that China, you know, has the capabilities as well as perhaps the will to counter U.S. intervention and to punish Taiwan if further steps towards independence are taken. It is also, interestingly enough, used misinformation in order to intimidate Taiwan. So in 2016, the PLA Air Force, this is just an example, released an image purporting to show an H-6K bomber flying in the vicinity of Jade Mountain, which is the highest point on Taiwan. This photo actually is fake. The HXK bomber did conduct a mission, but it did not come anywhere close to Taiwan. But the appearance that the PLA was coming very close to Taiwan had a psychological impact on the Taiwanese population, as well as to the larger community. Just another sign that China takes these threats of independence very, very seriously. China has also employed its large inventory of fighters to periodically and increasingly conduct provocative air operations near Taiwan. China has increasingly crossed the midline of the Taiwan Strait, which historically has been an unofficial boundary across which neither side is willing to employ military assets. But in the last year or two, China has frequently used its fighters to cross the midline of the Taiwan Strait, and it has also incurred into Taiwan's air defense identification zone. And so again, these are signals aimed both at Taiwan's leadership and at the population as a message to say, we have significant capability that we can use if you were to cross our red lines. China has also used military exercises as another deterrent signal targeting Taiwan. China and the PLA conduct regular amphibious exercises to maintain readiness if the PLA were ever called to conduct an island landing against Taiwan. But China also has sometimes publicized those exercises in certain ways, timed to persuade Taiwan not to cross Beijing's red lines. And so one example of this was last fall when they publicized major amphibious drills timed actually in that instance as a signal of dissatisfaction with the U.S. Sending high-level leaders to Taiwan in the fall. And so these exercises and drills are indeed aimed both at Taiwan as well as the United States. And then finally on this, China has also deployed and sometimes used in exercises long-range missiles, including the ones that I depicted here, the DF-26, DF-27, the DF-21D. So these are essentially long-range missiles whose purpose is to signal to the United States that China has the ability to hold U.S. forces in the region at risk. Not just U.S. bases in Japan and other countries, Guam, but also U.S. aircraft carriers and other major surface combatants, that China has the ability to target these assets and therefore deny the U.S. the ability to successfully intervene on behalf of Taiwan. And so China has also used parades, exercises, and so on as a tool to dissuade the United States from ever considering actually intervening on behalf of Taiwan in a conflict. Okay, so let me talk briefly here about how China and the PLA would potentially fight an actual conflict with Taiwan. So if we look at PLA doctrine, they really outline a number of different types of scenarios. But these should not be considered as exclusive or sort of alternatives. These should actually be considered sort of layered options. So you may start with one, but then progress to the next. So the first option here is a joint firepower strike. So this is a massed, joint conventional firepower attack on critical Taiwanese military infrastructure. And so the point here would be to stun Taiwan and to break the resolve of the Taiwanese population so that Taiwan's leaders would capitulate, give up, come to the negotiating table. If that were to fail, China also would consider implementing a blockade of Taiwan. And so it would use both its surface combatants, its subsurface fleet, as well as the Coast Guard, maritime militia, et cetera, to enforce a blockade that would, again, be intended to break Taiwanese resolve and to force them to come to the negotiating table. If that were to fail, then China would, on top of those options, consider conducting actual island landing, an amphibious operation against Taiwan itself. And so that would be the most, the high end, the most difficult option that they could undertake. But ultimately, it would be the only one that could guarantee success if it were to succeed. The others would essentially be coercive tools, and island landing would be sort of the ultimate solution to the problem for the PLA, but also the one hardest to achieve in practice. So how has PLA organization changed in order to achieve these goals? The PLA has been undergoing a series of major organizational reforms under Xi Jinping. The main purpose of this is to shift from a land force centric organization, so the one well attuned to defeating, you know, the United States or the Soviet Union in the Cold War, to a modern organizational structure based on joint commands. And so today, China has shifted to a system of theater commands. The Eastern Theater Command is primarily responsible for Taiwan. But the key here is that the commander has authority over most of the forces that he would need to be able to prosecute any of those campaigns, whether it's firepower, blockade, or an island landing. And so the organization now has been updated to match the requirements in doctrine and in strategy to be able to go to war successfully with Taiwan while also holding U.S. forces at risk. In terms of counter-intervention, this is really a linchpin of success for the PLA in any war with Taiwan, keeping the United States out. And so how would China do that? You know, so first of all, I mentioned the long-range conventional missiles that China would use potentially or threaten to use to keep the U.S. at bay. China would also likely try to use cyber warfare to challenge U.S. networks, command and control systems, logistics hubs, and so on. But on top of this, China would also, I think, use a political strategy to try to persuade countries that host U.S. forces, whether it's the Philippines or Japan, Australia, et cetera, to stay out of the fight and to deny the use of those facilities to forward deploy U.S. forces. And so the image here comes from a recent article suggesting that many countries, if asked by the United States to use their facilities in a conflict over Taiwan, would likely say no. And so whether or not this is the case sort of remains to be seen. But it's likely that China, which has, you know, extensive economic ties and relations with all of these countries, would put maximum pressure on them to deny the U.S. the use of airports, ports, logistics hubs, and so on and so forth. All right, so what can we say about the weaknesses of the PLA in being able to carry out its warfighting plans against Taiwan? So number one, in an island landing scenario, the PLA has never built adequate sea lift or airlift to be able to transport enough troops across the Taiwan Strait to be able to achieve its objectives. It simply hasn't done that. And you know, the reason here is that China has many other global and regional obligations, which I'll get to in a minute, I think. But in order to do this, they would have to use a crash program of development to be able to build sufficient military sea lift and enough transport airlift capacity to be able to ferry troops across the Taiwan Strait, and they haven't done that so far. But if they did start to do that, that would be a very clear indication of their intentions. Taiwan itself is also despite its proximity to the mainland, it's a formidable military target. The geography is difficult. There are only a few potential viable landing sites for the PLA. Much of the terrain is mountainous. The Taiwan Strait itself is difficult to cross for much of the year due to typhoon season. So there are limited windows for the PLA to be able to conduct these operations. Chinese doctrine is also very unclear about what would happen after an initial invasion. So you cross the strait, you establish a beach, but then Chinese doctrine doesn't really specify what then. And so if there were a counterinsurgency, if there were an insurgency rather in Taiwan, China doesn't necessarily have the training to be able to counter that insurgency. The PLA, just as a general note, lacks recent combat experience of any type. They have not fought a war since 1979, and they haven't fought really any kind of combat engagement of any sort since the late 1980s, with the exception of recent fisticuffs in the Sino-Indian border. And so despite their new organization, despite combat realistic training and so on, it's unclear, even to the PLA itself, how they would actually fight, because they don't have combat experience. The organizational culture of the PLA remains somewhat wedded to a ground force centric big army mentality. Jointness is new to the PLA, and yet to be able to prosecute any of the major cross-strait campaigns, you need a very, very good cooperation between the services and branches. And yet in areas ranging from training to military education, just to organizational culture in general, the PLA remains ground force centric, in my view, and has a ways to go before it can really develop something like what we would consider a joint mentality. And then finally, the nature of PLA decision-making in a conflict, I think, would be highly centralized. They do not have the same concept of devolving authority to lower-level commanders that the U.S. military has done, in part because China and the PLA, it's a Leninist system in which decision-making is often conducted at the very top, in which decisions are often micromanaged. And so this kind of decision-making process is not particularly well suited to modern combat, in which the speed and the intensity and unpredictability of combat require lower level officers to be able to make decisions. And yet that's really not how the PLA operates. The broader constraint, though, on China's ability to fight a war with Taiwan, I think, is this. The PLA not only has to prepare for a conflict with Taiwan, I reference this as a primary planning scenario for the PLA, but it has many, many other things that it needs to be able to do, both in peacetime and potentially in a wartime scenario. And so this is reflected in the nature of the theater command system that the PLA established 5 years ago. And so instead of creating a single large joint command solely focused on Taiwan, what they did was to create five theater commands, and each of the theater commands is focused on a specific set of regional contingencies. So the Western Theater, for instance, is focused on India, and they've been involved in the recent flare-up with India. The Southern Theater Command focuses on the South China Sea, and they've been involved in different flare-ups with Vietnam, with others in the South China Sea recently. The Northern Theater Command would be responsible for a contingency with North Korea, and the Central Theater Command has to act essentially as a reserve to the other theaters. China's major combat capabilities are also relatively equally divided between the theater commands. And so what this means is that they have not put all of their eggs in the Taiwan basket. Let's put it like that. They have divided up their forces because their security environment demands that they be able to do many different kinds of things. And so this basically functions as a constraint on China's capacity to initiate and to escalate a conflict against a single opponent, which is Taiwan. All right, so where does this leave the United States? Where does this leave Taiwan in terms of responses and defenses? All right, so I'll break my comments here into two different parts. First of all, what does Taiwan need to be able to do in peacetime? Really what they need to be able to do is to resist Chinese coercion. So that ranges from China interfering in Taiwan's air defense identification zone, provocative bomber operations, provocative naval operations, and so on. This also includes the potential that the PLA could try to seize one of Taiwan's smaller offshore islands. And so in order to do that, Taiwan needs credible conventional capabilities, including fighters, including surface ships, patrol craft, and so on, to be able to go and challenge those PLA operations so that their own population can be confident in their government, in their administration's ability to ward off Chinese threats. And so that means that they need to recapitalize, they need to acquire those systems, they need to maintain them and to recapitalize them, and in some cases to repair them so that they have the capabilities to resist coercion. All right. At a second level, they also need to be able to coordinate effectively with the United States, which is their primary defense partner in peacetime. And so for the United States, this raises the question of how we should deal with Taiwan in peacetime. And for successive U.S. administrations, this has been a careful balancing act. On one side of this, you need to be able to demonstrate a solidarity with Taiwan to provide adequate defensive capabilities. And in the face of an increasing Chinese threat, you need to consider whether some of that cooperation should be upgraded. But on the other side, you don't want to do things that are so provocative that China has no choice politically but to respond to them. And focus on Taiwan. And so this is a very tough balancing act for U.S. administrations. And so, but I think the key there is that the U.S. must do something because Taiwan ultimately left to its own devices cannot, in the face of a Chinese threat, survive a conflict. All right, so what does this leave Taiwan to face in wartime? So Taiwan's defense strategy has undergone a number of different changes over the years. Their current defense strategy is based on the idea that you need to be able to not so much fight the PLA head-to-head or platform against platform, but you need to be able to deny the PLA the ability to carry out their military objectives. So in a conflict, in a real conflict with the PLA, Taiwan would not really rely on those fighters, those surface ships, those other major large-scale platforms. Those would all be knocked out in the opening phases of a conflict. Rather, what Taiwan would do would be to rely on a smaller, more mobile, more survivable, and yet still lethal defensive capabilities to deny the PLA the ability to land on Taiwan or to successfully conduct a blockade against Taiwan. And so that has put a lot of emphasis on assets, many of which are quite inexpensive, but such as coastal defense cruise missiles, sea mines, multiple rocket launchers, Stinger missiles, if you're concerned about the PLA airborne campaign, and so on. And so Taiwan, I think, recognizes that you need to acquire these types of systems. And for the United States point of view, the idea is that you need to be able to make some of these defense articles available to Taiwan. And so if we look at U.S. defense sales to Taiwan over the last couple of years, many of them have involved these sorts of systems as opposed to fighters and destroyers and things of that nature, which have less applicability in a conflict. Okay, so what can we say about the weaknesses in Taiwan's defense strategy, which they call the overall defense concept? You know, first of all, this is heavily focused on countering an island landing. This says very little about how Taiwan would confront PLA coercion in peacetime, and it says very little about how Taiwan would resist or repair or survive lower uses of force by the PLA, including a fire strike campaign, or even necessarily parts of a blockade. So it's very myopically focused on the high-end scenario, and so the question is whether or not it gives adequate attention to those other scenarios. And secondly, there in Taiwan, as in any other country, there are service equities at stake. And so the services, for their own reasons, budgetary and otherwise, like to have large platforms like fighters, like destroyers. And yet in wartime, those assets are not very well connected to the defense strategy. And so with a limited defense budget, Taiwan has to make very hard choices between those sorts of prestige systems, if you will, and more of the assets that it would actually need to implement the strategy. And again, you know, defense strategy has been fairly limited. It's been increasing somewhat under the Tsai Ing-wen administration, but it remains relatively low. And then another challenge Taiwan faces is in terms of human capital. They are moving slowly towards an all-volunteer force, but at the same time, they are facing significant recruitment challenges in being able to man an all-volunteer force with the type of expertise that you would need to go, in some sense, toe-to-toe with the PLA. And then finally, for the United States, in turning to wartime, as I mentioned earlier, kind of the critical weakness of the U.S. way of war is reliance on overseas bases, whether it's in Japan, the Philippines, et cetera. And so recently, the U.S. Has started to move towards a different model of war fighting, which would rely less on large overseas bases that could be placed under vulnerability by the PLA, and moving to different models, whether it's distributed operations by the Navy, whether it's much smaller footprint operations by the Marine Corps, whether it's long-range strike by the Air Force, or whether it's moving to ground-based, long-range ground-based missiles operated by the Army. And so all of these are, in a sense, responses to the counterintervention threat posed by the PLA, and that would allow, that would aim to allow U.S. forces to be able to continue to operate and intervene and strike PLA assets in wartime. And those need to be merged into a concept of joint warfighting that remains still under development, so that we can move to a situation where in wartime the PLA could be successfully countered, and which in peacetime would raise significant questions among the PLA and among Chinese leadership in their ability to fully, you know, execute those war plans, and thus deter China from using force. And so I think that's kind of the direction that both Taiwan and the United States need to go in for Taiwan to have assurance that that it will be safe out to the next 10 years, 20 years, and even farther into the future. Okay, so why don't I stop there and turn it back over to Professor Ulbrich.
Thank you so much, Dr. Wuthnow. I appreciate your very candid and very spirited and informative presentation. So now we're going to move to some questions from the audience. So here we go. First question. When the United States recognized the People's Republic of China, didn't the United States make commitments to China acknowledging that Taiwan was part of China? The questioner recalls a statement that indicated no U.S. official would do anything to encourage Taiwanese independence.
Yeah, so in the 1970s, when the U.S. shifted its recognition from Taipei to Beijing, sort of beginning with Nixon's visit in 1972 and then moving to normalization of relations with China in 1979, there were three communiques that were agreed to with China, one of which contained a one China policy. And so what that really stated was that the U.S. acknowledged that both China and Taiwan viewed something called one China. And so that there was an acknowledgement that both sides agreed to this. But the U.S. position has never been to take sides, but just simply to acknowledge that that was the political situation between Taipei and Beijing at the time. And now I think what's also worth recognizing is that as a result of switching recognition in 1979, the U.S. also, Congress also signed the Taiwan Relations Act, which required the United States to provide defensive articles sufficient to deter China. And so successive U.S. administrations have been walking a fine line between both of those commitments. On the one side, to acknowledge that both sides have talked about one China, but then on the other side, to provide enough defensive capability to Taiwan that China is not tempted to use force and to unilaterally change the status quo. And so that's been a matter of policy for many, many years. And now in the current context, you have some folks who, you know, occasionally talk about, you know, walking back some of those commitments. But, you know, it's notable that administrations ranging all the way through the Trump and Biden administrations have been very, you know, very clear that those three communiques remain in force. And, you know, the reason I think is that the U.S. has stakes both in stability with China, but also stakes in protecting Taiwan's democracy. And that and those trade-offs and those balancing acts remain, I think, to this day.
Thank you. All right. Another question. Would you agree or disagree that the inflection point for China's decision to launch any assault on Taiwan is largely dependent on the success or failure of their ability to achieve leading edge semiconductor production capability on the Chinese mainland?
No, I don't agree. I think that China's decision on using force against Taiwan would be made with many different considerations in mind, but especially the party's ultimate survival, I think, would be the primary consideration. You know, and we have to ask why after 30 years of being concerned about Taiwan independence, Beijing has not used lethal force against Taiwan. What has held it back? You know, and I think the reason is this. You know, on one hand, Beijing has been relatively successful in accomplishing its near-term objective, which is deterring formal Taiwan independence. They've actually been able to achieve that through military buildup, through coercion. But they haven't actually used force. Why? Well, politically, there was no need to. There were no street protests. There were no people calling for the party to do this. And so their own survival hasn't been at stake. And so what would have to change? And yet they would also have a lot to lose. In particular, their economy would take a major hit. Their relations with the United States, with others in the region, would be devastated, and so on. And so you don't have much to gain and potentially quite a lot to lose. And so what would have to take place to change that calculus? Well, if, for instance, there was a major economic crisis within China, and the party was trying to, let's say, divert attention or create a scapegoat or something, they may change their calculus. If they were significantly less interested in their relationship with the United States, with Japan, with others in the region, then potentially the cost of using force would be lower, and that would make it easier to use force. And yet, for decades, this basic calculus has remained in place. And in my view, it would take something really dramatic. The party would have to have its back up against a wall, and they would have to perceive a different benefit, cost, and risk calculation, I think, to be able to accept those very significant remaining risks of using force against Taiwan and the United States.
Thank you. Can you address a little bit more about the United States pivot to the Pacific in terms of some maybe force structures or capabilities? And the questioner is asking about the U.S. Marine Corps and its recent focus on amphibious operations in the Pacific at the expense of all other possible missions.
Well, as a matter of fact, each of the services is trying to understand at present the role that it should play in supporting an Indo-Pacific strategy. The pivot to the Pacific refers specifically to language that was used during the Obama administration. They refer to a pivot to Asia, a rebalance to Asia. But truly, the shift in U.S. strategic attention to Asia has been ongoing in one way or another since the end of the Cold War, and in particular since the George W. Bush administration. And it was, in fact, the Bush administration's Quadrennial Defense Review that envisioned a relative shift in U.S. military resources to include 60% of the Navy, 60% of the Air Force to the Pacific theater. The Bush administration also began the negotiations on the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, different bilateral FTAs, and other regional initiatives to move the brunt, the center of gravity of U.S. strategy towards the Pacific. The Obama administration came in. They argued that the U.S. was strategically underinvested in Asia, given our economic interests, that we needed to continue and in some ways accelerate those trends. That continued under the Trump administration as well, which outlined what they called the free and open Indo-Pacific strategy. And then now we're into the Biden administration. But it's been very consistent that there has been a movement for the military, for the individual services, to be able to think more about how they can contribute to Asia, Indo-Pacific regional contingencies. And I think that impetus has only accelerated as the U.S. Wars in Afghanistan and Iraq have drawn down, and we're beginning to focus much more on great power competition and potential great power war. And so the Marine Corps, I think, in their shift to advanced expeditionary base operations, the Navy moving to distributed lethality, the Army even, which you wouldn't think of as a normal candidate to be a key player in this, given that this is a heavily maritime theater, they too have been considering the critical role they will play as part of the joint force in the Pacific. And so all of that, I think, is very consistent with the change in U.S. strategy after the Cold War and the movement of under the last few administrations to be able to focus more on how the U.S. will defend its allies and even potentially be able to fight a conflict with China or North Korea in the Indo-Pacific.
Thank you. Next question. To what degree does China's militarization of the South China Sea play a role in its Taiwan strategy?
So I think kind of the background of the question is that starting a number of years ago, China began to expand its military presence in the South China Sea, in particular in the Spratlys, which is much farther away from China's coast. And they have done this by, in particular, by reclaiming large amounts of land in the Spratlys and developing military outposts in the South China Sea, both for the PLA, but also to be used by the China Coast Guard, the fishing fleets, and so on. And so that has really significantly changed the military balance in the South China Sea, despite President Xi Jinping's affirmation during the Obama administration that China would not militarize the South China Sea, and yet they went ahead and they did it anyway. And so what does this apply for the Taiwan Strait, potential crisis in the Taiwan Strait? At face value, it doesn't imply very much. On one hand, China would be better positioned to strike Taiwan's outpost in the South China Sea, which is on an island called Ituaba. They could also potentially use long-range fires positioned from those military outposts to further complicate U.S. intervention. But really, China has a number of fixed targets in the South China Sea. And so, just as Taiwan faces the challenge, the U.S. faces the challenge of, vulnerability of large fixed targets such as airstrips and hardened, fixed infrastructure, the PLA would basically face the same exact challenge in the South China Sea. If those pose significant military risks to Taiwan or the United States, those would be first on the targeting list, frankly. And so I think, in peacetime, China, continues to operate from those facilities, but those are much less relevant to Taiwan, in part because Taiwan's claims in the South China Sea overlap with the mainland. There's no disagreement between the two. And so those operations are really focused much more on countering Vietnam, countering U.S. operations in the South China Sea, and countering, in some cases, the Philippines. And so I think that's kind of how I would come down on that question.
Thank you. Next question. Has the PLA fully incorporated or fully understood the Western way of war or the American way of war in their planning?
Well, they certainly tried to copy it. So I think kind of the longer answer I would give you is that going back to the 1980s and the Gulf War in the 1990s, the PLA felt a great sense of anxiety that they were not well equipped or organized or trained to be able to fight modern wars. And so they paid a tremendous amount of attention to the Gulf War in particular. They were shocked, really, at how easy it was for the United States to defeat an otherwise, very well-equipped modern military in a very short amount of time. And what they took away from that was that the U.S. Did not just simply operate individual systems. They operated an entire system of systems in which command and control, ISR, major combat platforms were linked together through information systems, and where they could conduct distributed operations and integrated joint operations very, very effectively at long distances from the U.S. homeland. And so they needed to understand that, first because China could be next on the U.S. list, so they needed to be able to defend against those operations, but secondly, they needed in some sense to be able to emulate parts of that way of war, if you will, if they were ever to be able to operate offshore in an integrated joint fashion themselves. And so what this led to was a series of reforms beginning in the 1990s that prioritized joint training, joint command and control, which has been, as I said earlier, a very big theme of recent reforms under Xi Jinping. They developed joint doctrine and they attempted to what they would call as informationization of the PLA. So linking all these individual systems together into a system of systems. So they have tried to emulate. Now, what's different? What is different in the Chinese system from the US? So there are a lot of different things, but one thing I would again highlight would be organizational culture. So the US has a philosophy of mission command, wherein lower level commanders and officers have quite a lot of discretion to be able to make decisions and to be able to act effectively and to take the initiative, respond to changing circumstances. But the PLA's mindset is very different from that. Lower level officers in the PLA need to defer. They need to get high level approval, all the way up to the Central Military Commission. And so the incentives of those officers, you know, is never to go out on a limb and to make quick decisions, because you will be the first person to be blamed. Their incentive is to get as high level approval as possible for anything. And then from a top down perspective, their incentive is to try to micromanage everything, because frankly, they're a limb in the system and that's how they operate. So even as they try to adopt the structure and some of the attitudes of a US style system, they've maintained in some very real sense a Leninist organizational culture, decision-making process, and so on. And so reconciling those two things, I think, for the PLA is very, very difficult. And that's something that if you're a US planner, you want to try to take advantage of. So what you want to do in a conflict with the PLA is to be able to organize unpredictable, fast, high-intensity operations that the PLA, that would confuse and stun the PLA and play to their weakness in having this, you know, highly overly centralized decision-making system where they cannot respond very quickly or effectively to rapid, unpredictable changes on the battlefield. And so that's, I think, going to be a core as the U.S. develops the joint warfighting concept. I think, you know, that's a critical weakness on the PLA side that we need to be able to understand how to leverage more effectively.
Thank you. The next is has a couple of parts to it. The next question has a couple of parts to it. Is a kinetic action really a credible threat when China has gotten a lot more return on investment for cyber and propaganda initiatives, given what we've seen in Hong Kong, where a slow coup took place while the world did very little? Is this more likely a course of action? Would the United States and the world community risk intervention on behalf of Taiwan, given the lack of toothy response in Hong Kong?
So I think I agree with kind of the first part of the question, which is that, you know, China sees, you know, a very high rate of return on investments in cyber capabilities. And in fact, they have been using different kinds of cyber operations against Taiwan over the years, whether that is in terms of, as I mentioned earlier, intentional misinformation, whether that is in terms of targeting critical infrastructure, whether that is, you know, anything from spear phishing against Taiwanese officials and intelligence gathering and so on. They have done all of that. They've been doing it quite a lot. And cyber operations would also in various ways play into PLA use of force in wartime. And so, you know, they have been able to do that. They have, in fact, marshaled and consolidated a lot of those capabilities. They, 5 years ago, set up the Strategic Support Force as sort of a general clearinghouse for information warfare, combining and merging PLA capabilities in psychological warfare, in cyber, in space, in electronic warfare. And so they have taken that very seriously. There are, though, some fairly notable differences between the situation in Hong Kong and the you know, potential use of force against Taiwan. You know, Hong Kong is a city, and, you know, the PLA was able, I think, you know, to basically stand back and let the Hong Kong police do a lot of the action there, and they have, you know, as I think you all know, just simply passed a national security law, and they've gone in and, you know, used their own agents in Hong Kong to round up dissenters and so on, and they've really changed the situation there dramatically. Taiwan is a self-governing democracy that, you know, offshore, China has no agents in, you know, Taiwan. Taiwan has a very deep and detailed defense relationship with the United States. And, you know, so being able to go in and, you know, change things so easily as they did in Hong Kong would be much, much, much more difficult with in the case of Taiwan. So, you know, I think Taiwan, for its purposes, needs to be very, you know, very cautious. They have, you know, people in Taiwan have observed the situation in Hong Kong. They have seen that, you know, China's promise to carry out a, you know, one country, two system formula for governance is not credible. And so I think in Taiwan that has significantly eroded whatever small amount of support for unification was left. You know, so they have taken that example under advisement. But, you know, whether or not, you know, China can simply, you know, walk in as they did in Hong Kong, I think, you know, from that point of view, the situation is night and day different.
Thank you. We have time for two more questions. So one of those is, to what extent, in your opinion, will be the backstop for the United States intervention? In short, when would the United States stop aiding Taiwan and abandoning the and then abandon the island altogether?
Okay. Well, you know, the short answer is that it's, you know, I don't know. You know, it's we've never really been clear about what our red lines are. And in fact, the United States has, you know, adopted this policy of strategic ambiguity for many, many years. And the rationale behind being ambiguous about the nature of U.S. commitments is this. On the one hand, you know, if you are clear about commitments, the fear is that you would embolden the Taiwanese to be more assertive and thus invite conflict. And yet, if you were clear that you would not intervene, you would you know, clearly invite the PLA to do whatever they wanted. And so that's been the basis of strategic ambiguity. And you know, there has been a very significant debate now about whether or not we should actually be clearer about our commitments and, you know, basically put our reputation on the line and say clearly that the US would absolutely intervene regardless of China's use of force. You know, and so some folks make that argument. The counter argument is that if you do that, you know, it's not so much that, you know, Taiwan would, you know, suddenly declare independence, you know, probably not, but that you might put your reputation on the line and then ultimately, you know, in an actual crisis, not follow through on that and therefore lose quite a lot of, you know, reputational, you know, credibility, you know, across the whole region. And so, you know, really what a future administration or this administration would do in a, you know, actual Taiwan crisis, you know, is unclear. I think, you know, the calculus would depend on, you know, whether or not the, you know, there is a sense that the U.S. could successfully intervene on time and whether or not, you know, the cost would be astronomical and also the PLA's effectiveness and success in being able to deter the U.S. By denying it the ability to carry out the U.S. U.S. operational plans, including by targeting, you know, those critical U.S. bases. And so I think, you know, an administration would take all of those factors into consideration and decide, you know, militarily, strategically, and finally politically, is this something that we can afford to do? But because we haven't been put in that position, there's no track record of knowing, you know, how previous administrations have handled it. And so it's really a critical unknown. What I would say though is that from a PLA planning point of view, they absolutely assume that we will intervene. They don't allow themselves the luxury of thinking that we wouldn't intervene. And so they plan based on that contingency, and that explains a lot of their force modernization training and operations.
Thank you. Last question. What would happen if the People's Republic of China attacked those small islands that Taiwan owns instead of attacking the main Taiwanese island?
So this is a potential contingency that has gained some attention in recent years. You know, the PLA has differential capabilities to intervene, to seize, even to occupy some of Taiwan's you know, offshore islands. Some of those are occupied. You know, for instance, there's Jinmen and Matsu, which are very, very close to the coast of Fujian. So those are actually occupied. There are also unoccupied, you know, islands. And so, you know, part of the equation is whether or not China would be willing to use lethal force. If you use lethal force, you send a much stronger signal to Taipei. But, you know, you also invite, you know, risk of escalation. You know, from a capabilities point of view, you know, they could certainly go in. They have the amphibious lift, the training, the equipment to go in, even just with their Marine Corps, you know, let alone the Army, to be able to go in and seize, you know, those islands. But they haven't done so. You know, that is a threat that they like to hold over Taiwan. If you actually carry through on the threat, then you kind of be fired around that you don't have anymore. So I think that's part of it. You know, and also they, you know, I think with respect to using lethal force, they would be concerned about escalation. But, you know, from a military point of view, if they went in and they did that, then they could move their front lines closer to Taiwan. And so that, I think, is very, very concerning. If they were to militarize and occupy some of those offshore islands, those would basically be staging bases for an invasion of Taiwan. So I think that's something that Taiwan takes very seriously. And the question of how you defend those outposts, you know, especially the ones very close to the mainland, you know, that's been challenging for Taiwan since the 1950s. And so, you know, I don't know what the answer would be, but for now, you know, sort of deterrence has held, but I don't think we can rule such operations out in the near term. And in fact, it's probably likelier than, you know, directed much higher escalatory actions against Taiwan mainland itself.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wuthnow. For our closing remarks, I'm going to turn things back over to Dr. Yang Moku.
Dr. Joel Wuthnow, thank you so much for your insightful talk and great answers. And Dr. David Ulbrich, I appreciate your smooth moderator role. Everyone, thank you so much for participating in today's summit session. Next Wednesday at 1 p.m., we will address another significant topic, U.S.-China maritime dispute in the South China Sea area. The two speakers, like Dr. Krista Wiegand and Dr. Jesse Vu Ellison at University of Tennessee at Knoxville, will address this topic. I hope many of you can join that session as well. And have a great day, great week. And thank you so much again. See you next week.